Hey everyone, I'm Pastor Brian. Super glad that you're here this morning. I want to welcome you to Trinity today. Thanks for taking the time to worship with us. If you're new to Trinity, we're super glad that you're here. And there's a few important things we want you to be aware of. First of all, out in our foyer is our welcome center. Please make sure to stop by after worship. We have a gift for you and we'd like to get to know you better. Second, if you're here with kids, that's awesome. We're a multi-generational church, and we love it when the whole family worships together. But to assist families with young children, we have church bags that are out in the foyer. And for children 3 and under, we have a nursery with a warm, welcoming, and trained staff, if that's helpful for you. And for those kids ages 4 through 8, we also have children's church, which takes place at the same time as the adult message. Finally, we want you to know that everything we do here at Trinity has a purpose: to help people know Jesus and to grow as His fully devoted followers. We believe that this happens best when people actively engage God, engage God's people, and engage the world. Here's a few of the ways that you can do this here at Trinity.
Are you looking for a way to engage the world with Christ's love? If so, then look no further. Trinity's impact missions are doing just that. We're ministering to the least of our brothers and sisters at the Family of God Mission in Detroit. We're bringing hope to families and help to women experiencing a crisis pregnancy through Compassion Pregnancy Center. We're building homes and changing lives through Macomb Habitat for Humanity. And we're taking the gospel to the ends of the earth as we support Groundwork Guatemala. Find out more about how you can make a mission impact in God's kingdom. Check out the impact mission display in the foyer or talk with one of our mission leaders. We need you to make an impact.
Trinity will soon tip off its 8th season of Upward Basketball and Cheerleading. Hi, I'm Randy Wade. Upward Sports is an outreach ministry from the ages of kindergarten through the 6th grade. They combine solid sport instruction and skill development with a ministry component that introduces children to Jesus. In fact, Upward's mission is to promote the discovery of Jesus through sports. In order to have another great year, we need 4 things from you. Number 1, please pray for the ministry. Number 2, get the kids signed up. Registration is now open. Number 3, invite your friends. Number 4, we need volunteers. We need coaches, referees, scorekeepers, and more. For more info, check us out on our website or visit us out in the foyer after the service.
On Sunday, October 9th, from 3 to 6 p.m., we'll be hosting our Parish Pizza Pumpkin Picnic. That's right, the Quadruple P. This is an afternoon designed for families and friends to connect with one another and to have some fun. The Quadruple P features pumpkin painting, pony rides, pizza, and lots more. Last year, over 300 people turned out and had a great time. Now, if you're planning to attend, please let us know by signing up in the church foyer. In order to make this a successful event, we need volunteers. So if you'd like to volunteer, you too can sign up at the table in the church foyer. So go ahead and mark your calendars for October 9th. Well, that's it for this week. We'd love for you to connect with us online. So check out our website and our Facebook page. You can find updated information on everything that's happening in our church, our school, and our early childhood center. I hope your experience at Trinity is a blessing to you today. Have a great week, and we'll see you soon. October 9th. Well, that's it for this week. We'd love for you to connect with us online. So check out our website and our Facebook page. You can find updated information on everything that's happening in our church, our school, and our early childhood center. I hope your experience at Trinity is a blessing to you today. Have a great week, and we'll see you soon.
Good morning, church. Some of you are figuring out how I'm living in 2 places, both in a screen and live. It's crazy, I know. But it's okay. My name is Pastor Brian. If I've never met you, would love to. Not now, afterwards. Let's do that. Behind me is Pastor Ken Wise. Somewhere here is Pastor Gary Richard. Super glad that you're in this place this morning in God's house to hear again in His Word and to come around His gifts. So blessed to have you. Listen, if you're a newcomer and you don't know what's going on, ask your neighbor. They're going to look at you weird because they're not used to people talking to them, but talk to them anyway. It's good for them, okay? If you want to know about something, ask them. It's really okay. They'll point you in the right direction. Two things I want to draw your attention to this morning. Number one, if you weren't here last weekend to take part in our engagement survey, we want you to do that. So if you call Trinity Home and want to do that for us, you can still do that today. But to do that, you have to go to the Welcome Center. So after church, go out to that Welcome Center and you can take that survey. It takes 4 or 5 minutes to do. So if you didn't do it last weekend and you can after worship, I want to encourage you to go to the Welcome Center afterwards. Now, number two, coming up is our Parish Pumpkin Pizza Picnic Palooza. That's 5 P's in a row. So if you've never been, it's an incredible family event. But here's what I need from you. Church, listen up. I need you to sign up. Now, here's why I'm telling you this. In 3 years that I've been here at Trinity, here's what I know about you. Y'all don't like to sign up. And then y'all show up, and we don't have food for you, and you wonder why the church doesn't feed you. Here's why. Y'all don't sign up. It's really easy. So, in order to make sure that we can feed all the people who come, we really, 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 really need you to sign up. We need you to write your name down, to let us know that you're coming, you and your family. So, again, after church, out in the lobby is a place to sign up. If you plan to be here, please, please let us know that you're coming. All right? Would we all just nod our heads? Some of you are still listening. Fantastic. Here's what I'd like you to do. Why don't we stand up, greet those around you, say good morning, give away some peace this morning and some joy.
Gather in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Father, we give thanks for waking us up again to gather as a church and join as one voice to lift our songs in praise to you for all that you've done for us. We are truly thankful and ask that today every day we encounter you in our lives. Help us to see those times and to give thanks for those times that you are with us. And so today we just join as brothers and sisters in Jesus' most precious name. Amen. And we remember the psalmist this morning who says, "Bless the Lord, my soul, and all that is within me." And so we sing this song with those who have gone before us for many, many years. And it goes like this. Here we go. Sing it with me.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul. Bless the Lord, oh my soul. strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name, let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to save but your name.
Invite that spirit into our hearts this morning. Holy Spirit, come. Holy Spirit, dwell. Fill your church with joy overflowing and peace overflowing. Thank you.
sisters and brothers, we have the opportunity this morning to join our hearts together and to admit our weakness, to confess to God those places of our heart that are weak to follow Him. So friends, I invite you to join me as we confess together the words on screen. Gracious God, we confess to you that we are in bondage to sin and cannot set ourselves free. We own the truth that our sins are too heavy to carry, too real to ignore, and too tangled to undo. Still, we falsely and futilely rely upon our own power and strength to overcome our sin, to come to you, and to live for you. Do for us, Lord, what we cannot do for ourselves. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us so that we can walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Through the power of his death and resurrection, Christ Jesus has secured forgiveness with God. In his name and by his authority, therefore, I forgive you all of your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Friends, receive this promise today in faith and live in the strength of his grace. Amen? Amen. You may be seated as we sing.
Thank you.
The reading for today comes from 2 Corinthians, the 12th chapter. I must go on boasting, although there is nothing to be gained. I will go on to visions and revelations from the Lord. I know a man in Christ who 14 years ago was called up to the third heaven. Whether it was in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows, and I know that this man, whether in the body or apart from the body, I do not know, but God knows, was caught up to paradise and heard inexpressible things, things that no one is permitted to tell. I will boast about a man like that, but I will not boast about myself, except about my weaknesses. Even if I should choose to boast, I would not be a fool because I would be speaking the truth. But I refrain, so no one will think more of me than is warranted by what I do or say, or because of these surpassingly great revelations. Therefore, in order to keep me from becoming conceited, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan, to torment me. 3 times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me, but he said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness." Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that the Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weakness, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong. This is God's word for us.
Sisters and brothers, I invite you to stand as we hear the gospel this morning. Now, that word comes to us this morning from Mark's gospel, Mark chapter 15. We start at verse 27. They crucified 2 rebels with him, one on his right and one on his left. Now, those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, "So, you who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, come down from the cross and save yourself." And in the same way, the chief priests and the teachers of the law mocked him among themselves. "He saved others," they said, "but he can't save himself. Let this Messiah, this King of Israel, come down now from the cross that we might see and believe." Well, those crucified with him also heaped insults on him. Friends, this is God's word for us today. As a church, we believe in God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. We don't say these words just to say these words, friends. If people want to know what we believe, we give them these words. This is what we believe. And so if that's you, I want to invite you to confess together this Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, who suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried, and he descended into hell. And the 3rd day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven, and he sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. And from thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated as we sing together.
Strength will rise as we wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord. We will wait upon the Lord.
Amen. Kids church time. Children ages 4 to 8. If they'd like to be part of children's church, they can follow Mr. Ashley and follow the cross. Folks, if you're a guest with us today and you have children here and you want to know what in the world's going on, they're going out to children's church for a few minutes. They'll come back right after the message today, so keep an eye out for them. If you'd like them to participate, that'd be great. We're going to bow our heads, folks. We're going to pray for the kids this morning. Lord, we sing in that what we think is a children's song, Jesus Loves Me, This I Know, and we sing in there that I am weak, but He is strong. Today, Lord God, I pray that the strength of Christ would be poured into them during this time of children's church. We pray for Mr. Ashley that you give him the words and the ways to communicate that well to them so that they grow closer to you and they become strong in your mighty name. And we pray it in that name. Amen. Well, friends, God's word for our special attention this morning is that first reading, the one that Gary shared with us from 2 Corinthians chapter 12. And as usual, I always encourage you to have that before you and let it be your guide for today. It's a scripture where that begins with Paul quoting Jesus, actually. And Jesus has said to the Apostle Paul, he said, "My grace is sufficient for you. My grace is all you need, for my power is made perfect in your weakness." And then Paul responds by saying, "Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses and insults and hardships and persecutions and difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong." And I pray, folks, that God would use His word to bless us, to grow our faith, to increase our love. Amen. Paul says some of the weirdest things. Kind of crazy, if you ask me. He says this. He says, "You know what? I'm going to boast all the more gladly in my weaknesses." In fact, he uses this word. He says, "For Christ's sake, I delight in it. I delight in weaknesses. I delight in insults and hardship and persecution. For when I'm weak, then I'm strong." Paul says weird stuff. No one wants to be weak. No one I've ever met. No one delights in weaknesses. Just the opposite. We want to be strong. We want to be tough. We want to be powerful. We want to be independent. And we want to be in control. But folks, if you've been with us the last few weeks, we've come to realize that God has called us to live an upside-down life. And He's come, and we've come to realize that God's ways are often not our ways. Now, to make sense of all this, folks, we need to begin, however, by understanding a little more about what Paul talks about and what he means by weakness or weaknesses. You see, when Paul speaks of boasting and delighting in weaknesses in this context, he's not referring to emotional weakness. He's not saying, "Oh great, I'm a basket case today." He's not talking about physical weakness. He's not saying that we should have a weak faith where we live in perpetual doubt and indifference about the things of God. He's not saying that we should have a weak character that is always giving into temptation and always giving into sin. That's not what Paul's talking about. Paul is saying that he boasts, and as I said, he delights, and that word means that he finds a benefit, he takes satisfaction in. He delights in those times and places and experiences in life where he has no one and nothing else to hang on to but Christ. That's what he's talking about. Weakness here refers to our times, folks, our times and our places of dependency.
When we are enduring things that are out of our control, things that we cannot fix, that which we have no ability and no sufficiency to escape or to overcome on our own. And Paul says it's in these times of weaknesses, folks, it's in these times of weaknesses that we are in fact the strongest. He is the strongest then because he has to depend upon God's strength and God's power and not his own. He's driven from a place of independence to dependence. He's driven from a place of self-sufficiency to God's sufficiency. He's driven from a place of being full of himself to a place where he has to be full of Christ and full of his grace. And that's what Paul's talking about in the scripture for today. Now we need to go a little farther and dig a little deeper to gain a little more understanding. You see, it's in our times of weakness, in our times of dependency and insufficiency that we are most likely, listen, it's in these times of weakness that we are most likely, most willingly, and most able to let God do his work in us and through us. It's not in our places of strength. It's in our places of weakness. It's in our weakness that we are most likely to surrender ourselves to God, to trust in his love and in his goodness, in his wisdom and in his power. Which means that in our weakness, that's when we are actually the strongest as well, because we are no longer living life out of our own limited, imperfect, earthly strength, but we are living in the unlimited, perfect, divine strength of Jesus Christ, and that's what matters. It always reminds me, folks, of the, if you're familiar with this at all, but it always reminds me of the way a 12-step program works for people who are dealing with addiction. Step one is always to admit that you are powerless over your addiction. That on your own, you cannot set yourself free. Recovery to addiction so often begins in this place, because it's not until we admit that place of weakness that we can find strength in someone or somewhere else outside of ourselves. Folks, it goes to the myth that so many of us have bought into. Maybe because we've preached it in the past incorrectly. Maybe because you read it on a bumper sticker. I don't know. But it goes to that myth that so many of us have bought into, that God will not give you anything more than you can handle. Well, that is absolutely, positively, 100% patently false. God is constantly giving us more than we can handle. God is constantly allowing us to have more than he can, but he never gives us more than he can handle. Because God's way for us is the way of weakness and dependency, so that we will find our strength in him and not in us. That's what's going on here. Now, oftentimes, folks, those moments and those experiences of weakness are placed upon us. But at times, we actually need to choose weakness in order to be strong. A news reporter was once interviewing the father of Rachel Scott. Now, I don't know if you remember her name. Rachel Scott is one of the teenagers that was killed in the shooting at Columbine High School in 1999. And they were interviewing Mr. Scott, who's a committed Christian. And when the cameras were off him, the news person kind of tapped him on the knee and they said, "You know, Mr. Scott, you are a very strong man." And this is what Mr. Scott's reply was. He said, "No, I'm not a very strong person. I'm a very weak person. And I choose that weakness because I've learned a secret that Rachel learned too. That God's grace is there when we choose to be weak. And so, yes, I'm strong, but it's in the strength of God's grace. It's not in my own strength." And he went on as he talked about the trying to forgive a person that would take his daughter's life. And he said, you have to acknowledge that you cannot forgive within your own strength. That's the first step of forgiveness. And I had to say, God, I cannot forgive Eric and Dylan, and I confess that weakness, but out of my weakness, your strength is made perfect. And this is why, folks, that St. Paul says, when I'm weak, then I'm strong. Where are you today? What place where you perceive strength? What do you need to confess as weakness today? What do you need to say to God, I can't do it anymore. I can't do it by myself. I can't take it. I can't accomplish it. I can't change it. I can't fix it. I can't overcome it. What do you need to lay before God? You see, folks, this really is the message that just rings true through the Psalms. If you've ever picked up the book of Psalms, here's what you do. Go home later today, and in your computer, just type in Bible Gateway or something like that, and type in the word strength. And then just go through the Psalms and see. You'll read it over and over and over and over and over again. And you'll hear things like this, Psalm 22. But you, Lord, do not be far from me, for you are my strength. Come quickly to help me. Or Psalm 28, the Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him and he helps me. Psalm 59, you are my strength. I watch for you. You, God, are my fortress. You are my strength. I sing praise to you. God, you are my fortress, the one upon whom I can rely. That's God's message to us today. You see, self-sufficiency, clinging to the notion that we are in control, clinging to the notion that we are strong, that we can handle life ourselves and on our own terms. Folks, self-sufficiency turns our hearts away from Christ because there is no room in that heart for two masters. There is no room for two kings in the castle. There is no place for two strong people to wrestle it out. But weakness, dependency, insults, hardship, persecution, difficulties, and even the moments that we have to choose that weakness, those moments and times and places and situations, they drive our hearts toward Christ. And when that happens, this miracle occurs that we're stronger than we ever thought we could be because we're strong in the strength of Christ. Yes, it's true. When we are weak, we are strong. Because, folks, in our weakness, that's when we're able to see more clearly the power and the grace of God at work in our lives. That's when we're able to see what God is actually able to do in us and to us and through us to impact the lives of other people. When we keep living life in such a way that we think that we're in control, we miss all of that. But that's the way the entire biblical story unfolds, folks. Story after story, account after account, we see God using weakness to bring out strength. For example, if you were to look in the Old Testament, this is not such a well-known story, but if you look in the Old Testament of your Bible to the book of Judges, there was a guy named Gideon. God called Gideon to lead the people of Israel in a battle to defeat the Midianite army. Gideon had over 22,000 people in his army. You know what God said? God said, that's too much for the battle. Cut a few out. And he did. And God said, no, that's still too much for the battle. Cut them out. Next thing you know, Gideon's left with 300 dudes. And the biblical text says this, the reason that God did that is he said, because if you go and fight that battle and you win that battle with 20,000 strong, you know what you're gonna do? You're gonna pat yourself on the back. You're gonna tell yourself how great you are. But when you go and take that battle with 600 people, 300 people, you're gonna know that God did this work, not yourself. And you're gonna discover real strength. You're gonna see God at work in the midst of weakness, or what appears to be weakness, to do amazing, powerful things. This may be kind of an age-related question in some regard, but how many of you, just a quick show of hands, how many of you are familiar with the name Chuck Colson? Chuck Colson. Some of you. Well, Chuck Colson served as special counsel to President Richard Nixon from 1969 to 1973. He was known as Richard Nixon's hatchet man because he did all the political dirty work. Now, he was the first member of the Nixon administration that was incarcerated relative to the Watergate break-in and cover-up of those days. And some of you are old enough to remember it, and others of you have read about it in a history book, perhaps. Chuck Colson spent 7 months in a federal prison for obstructing justice. Now, later on, he became a very committed follower of Jesus Christ, and he began a ministry called Prison Fellowship. But this is what he says about his life. Listen carefully to his assessment. He writes, "The great paradox of my life is that every time I walk into a prison and see the faces of men or women who have been transformed by the power of the living God, I realize that the thing God has chosen to use in my life is none of the successes, achievements, degrees, awards, honors, or cases I won before the Supreme Court. That's not what God's using in my life. What God is using in my life to touch the lives of thousands of other people is the fact that I was a convict and I went to prison. That was my great defeat, the only thing in my life I didn't succeed in. Yes, the weak are strong. If in our weakness, in our places of dependency, in our moments of insufficiency, when life hits in such a way that we are no longer in control, if in those moments we turn to and trust in and live our lives out of the strength of Christ, then yes, weakness becomes strength." And I get it, folks. It's hard for us. It's difficult. It is for me, too. It's so backward to our way of thinking and to our culture and to our upbringing. It means surrendering and giving up our self-sufficiency. It means giving up control. It means admitting that we are powerless to change or to overcome a particular circumstance or situation or to change another person or whatever it might be. But folks, we need to understand that this is the way of God. This is actually how God works. You can disagree with it, you can fight about it, you can kick against it, you can argue with it, you can do all that, but this is the way God does his thing. God chose to come to us in weakness, or what appeared as weakness, as a baby in a manger, as one absolutely powerless over their circumstances and someone absolutely dependent on other people. And Jesus Christ himself chose weakness in order to do his saving work. He didn't come in with guns blazing. It's not might, it's not armies, it's not lightning bolts from heaven. It's humility and suffering and sacrifice and a cross. Jesus chooses weakness. He chooses to surrender himself to those who hate him. He chooses to trust his heavenly Father When everything is spiraling out of control, and even though it doesn't make sense, he chooses to live in God's strength to complete his mission. He chooses to allow himself to be forsaken and to be crushed for us on Calvary. And it's in this weakness that he is the strongest of the strong. It's in his weakness, in this moment of suffering, that he is the strongest of the strong, because he takes this weakness of our sin and brokenness upon himself, and he carries your guilt and my guilt, and he lifts up and he pays your price and my price, and he dies your death and my death. And in the weakness of the cross, he does the most powerful, most amazing thing. He casts our sins away as far as the east is from the west. He pours out his grace on us in a way that is absolutely sufficient. All that we need for our brokenness, all that we need to live out this life of faith. His power to save and to rescue us from sin and death was made perfect through his weakness. And now his grace is all we need. God is oftentimes most God when he looks the least like God. He's often the most powerful when he comes in what looks like weakness and simplicity, as he did for us long ago. So yes, folks, the weak are strong. When we are weak, the power of Christ rests upon us. And that's what we need. When we are weak, God's grace is sufficient. When we can admit our need, God is there to fill us up. Yes, my grace is sufficient for you, says Jesus, and my power is made perfect in your weakness. And it is in that power that we are strong to follow him in his name. To God be the glory. In Jesus' holy and precious name, amen. And the peace of God that passes all of our human understanding, may it guard and keep our hearts and our minds in Christ today and each day. Amen. Folks, we're going to use this time. We're going to ask you to find the friendship pad. It's at the end of each row. Fill that out, pass it on to others. Again, if you are a guest with us this morning, if you're a newcomer, please stop by our welcome center in the foyer after worship so we can connect with you. And we also use this time to give our gifts and our offerings so that we can help others to know their weakness and their strength in Christ. Thank you.
As we go to prayer this morning, we do need to add a couple of names to the list of those we are praying for. We need to add the name of George Hayden, who's hospitalized. Frank Bone Briscoe, who has also been hospitalized. And there was a gentleman over here in the front over here that had to go out during the song before the sermon. He needs some medical care, and he's receiving that right now. His name is Ron. That's all I know is his first name is Ron. And so certainly we want to pray for Ron this morning as well, that God would bless him and touch him with his healing hand. And then for the family of Mike Harold. Mike went to be with the Lord yesterday afternoon, and many people here know him. His funeral will be later this week, and you'll just need to watch newspapers and things for those details. So as we go to prayer, if you'd like to kneel, if you'd like to stand, if you'd like to remain seated, whatever posture works so that you and the Lord can be drawn to each other, mostly that you can be drawn to him. He's here. So let's pray. Lord Jesus, thank you. Thank you for this day, and Lord, thank you for coming and living that upside-down life so perfectly for us. And it doesn't make sense that you would use someone so weak like a 12-year-old to slay the big giants. And yet, Lord, you do that. That's how you work. And so, Lord, we ask that because you're strong in our weakness, that you would actually make us weak. And you could be strong. And you would be built up and glorified. Lord, we pray for those who are ill and hospitalized, that you would watch over them this day. We pray for Frank and George and Ron, all who need your healing presence and all who we name in our hearts and in our minds, that you would just grant your healing presence in their lives and that you would be with them, be with their families, that you would grant a full measure of peace. Lord, for Mike's family this day, for Sue and the girls, for that circle of friends, that you would grant them your comfort, your peace, your presence, and that over these days of grieving and months of grieving, that you would watch over them. And Lord, we pray for those who celebrate birthdays, anniversaries, that they would celebrate in you, Lord, that you would be the focus of all of that celebration and all that is, that your name would be praised. We pray for our nation and its leaders, that you would work in hearts and minds, and guide those who lead in our nation to make good and godly decisions in their governance. Lord, you know there's an election coming up in about a month. So we pray for that process, that all of us who go and vote and participate in that would look to you for guidance and direction. And that, Lord, those people would be elected that you want to have elected. Lord, we pray for those who don't yet know Jesus as their Savior, for those who may have known you at one time but have fallen away, that you would send someone, some situation, something to them through the work of your Holy Spirit and through other believers, that they could come to faith and know Jesus in a real and personal way. And Lord, use us for that as your hands and your feet and your voice. Lord, we come to the foot of your cross and we lay all of our cares there, all of our thanksgivings, all of our praises, all that we are and all that we have, we give to you, Lord. We know that you hear us, and we trust that you will answer us, for we ask it all in the precious name of Jesus. Amen. And now please rise as we join our voices and our hearts together, and as we pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
You're calling, you're calling, you're calling.